Hello, my dear student friends. It's my pleasure to present my next video lesson for you from the core courses Embryology and Endocrinology. Today, I'm going to share my views on the next topic of the fourth unit from embryology and endocrinology, that is mechanism of action of hormones. We know that hormones are the endocrine secretions which play a pivotal role in maintaining homeostasis of our activities. In the previous video lesson, I told you that these endocrine secretions are secreted by various endocrine glands located in different regions of our body. You know that endocrine glands don't have any ducts, hence their secretions are directly poured into the blood. The blood is a carrying agent which carries the hormones to the respective target organs, where the hormones are bind with the respective receptors of the target cells, and they perform different types of actions as well as mechanisms. Today we are going to study about this. Okay, my dear students, in this video lesson I'm going to analyze the action of hormones on its target cell. In order to study the mechanism of action of hormones, we should know about five components. These five components are like that of our fingers in our hand. In other words, we can say they are the five elements of the universe. And correctly we can say these are the five receptors, like that of the five receptors of our body. We know that we have five important receptors. Eye is the photoreceptor, ear is the phonoreceptor, nose or the nasal chamber is olfactoreceptor, our tongue is the gustatoreceptors, and our finger as well as the skin is a tangoreceptor. All the receptors are function normally and they are interdependent with each other. Without one receptor, it is very difficult for the survival of the human being. Likewise, these components, already I told you that ligands, receptors, secondary messengers, transcription factors and intracellular activities are interdependent each other, because without one, it is very difficult to study the mechanism of action of hormone. In a nutshell, I can say hormone action needs these five components. Let me see one by one. The ligands are nothing but the molecules or the hormones. The secreted hormones requires receptors to bind on its target cell. Most of the receptors found on the surface of the target cells accept all kinds of hormones, but some of them are very specific to particular type of hormones only. These type of receptors are called ligands. ligands are have a specific affinity towards a specific type of hormones. They never accept other kinds of hormones to exhibit their reactions. And a third important factor is secondary messengers. After binding of the ligands on its specific receptors, they enters into the cell where there will be a protein called G protein. The G protein is activated. After the G protein is activated, various cascade reactions are occurred within the cell in order to do their functions. The cascade activities are nothing but the series of activities. By the series of activities, different types of secondary messengers are formed within the cell. Some of the secondary messengers may enter into the nucleus where it binds on the nuclear material with the help of transcription factors. So these transcription factors are very important in order to produce a new types of proteins. These new types of proteins are able to do various intracellular activities. Actually, this mechanism of action of hormone is a G protein coupled reaction. What is G protein? G protein is a specific type of membrane protein which is always associated with the receptors of the target cell. Here you can see the G protein. That G protein is always binds with another oval shaped protein. The oval shaped protein always called as a catalytic unit, which is called adenyl cyclase. Actually, this G protein is formed of three subunits, alpha, beta and gamma. G protein is guanyl nucleotide regulatory protein. Since it is formed of three subunits, during the time of action, these three subunits are dissociated and alpha unit becomes activated. Because alpha units are always attached with GDP. When it is attached to the GDP, it is an inactive stage. While they become active, they combined with GTP, by which more cyclic GMP are formed. This formed GMP reaches the inner protein, which is called protein kinase. That protein kinase performs different types of intracellular activities. For my convenience, I categorize the mechanism of reaction performed by different types of hormones into four aspects based on the performance done by a hormone on its target cell I named four theories. The first one is membrane permeability theory. And the second one is adenyl cyclase theory. And the third one is intracellular second messenger theory. And the fourth one is gene activation theory. Among the four theories, now I am going to explain membrane permeability theory. This theory says that after binding off a hormone molecule, the so-called ligand, on the surface of the receptors, it alters the permeability of the plasma membrane of the target cell, by which a new channel protein is formed. And this new channel protein is meant for either removal or absorption of a particular compound or a particular ion or a particular material from the cell or vice versa. See the picture. So in this picture, the first theory can easily explained. So this is a structure of the collecting duct of the nephron. Here you can see the nephron, which is formed of Bowman's capsule, glomerulus, proximal convoluted tubule, Henle loop, distal convoluted tubule, and here you can see the collecting duct. So collecting duct is a target organ for a hormone which is known as vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone. Diuresis is nothing but a dilution. This hormone acts as antidiuretic hormone. By the action of the hormone, the amount of water which will be eliminated from the body in the form of urine is greatly reduced. Say for example, we consume 3 to 4 liters of water every day, but we will not eliminate all the 3 to 4 liters of the water completely from the body. Only 750 ml to 1 liter of water is eliminated from the body in the form of urine. Then what happened to the remaining 3 liters of water? These 3 liters of water is absorbed. This absorption is achieved by the action of this hormone called vasopressin, or otherwise called antidiuretic hormone. We know that vasopressin or the antidiuretic hormone is secreted from the posterior pituitary gland. From there, it travels through the bloodstream and reaches the target organ, is the collecting duct of nephron, where it has a specific receptor called VP receptor. The name of the receptor is called VP receptor. With the help of the VP receptor, it binds on the surface of the collecting duct. The receptors are always associated with the G protein. Here you can see the G protein. That G protein is always attached with a nearby inherent enzymatic unit, which is called adenyl cyclase. And by this series of reactions, the adenyl cyclase activates the nearby enzymatic unit, which is called protein kinase A. Here you can see the protein kinase A. Actually, this protein kinase A is formed of two subunits. The first subunit is called regulatory subunits, and the second subunit is called catalytic subunit. That means the bottom or catalytic subunits. These catalytic subunits are able to secrete the new proteins. Here, the name of the new protein is known as aquaporins. So, aquaporins are nothing but the water channels. By the formation of the aquaporins, the water droplets which are found in the lumen of the collecting duct can easily reabsorb. So by this way, this hormone, the so-called antidiuretic hormone, alters the membrane permeability of the distal convoluted tubule or the collecting duct of the nephron, by which the 3 liters of water is reabsorbed. And the second mechanism of the hormone is adenyl cyclase or tyrosine kinase theory. In the previous diagram, I shown you a oval shaped catalytic unit that is called adenyl cyclase. This adenyl cyclase undergoes very important reaction, which is called phosphorylation and also dephosphorylation. These phosphorylation and dephosphorylation reactions are very, very essential, especially during the growth of the cell. Rightly, we can say at the time of cell cycle, this phosphorylation and dephosphorylation mediated by this adenyl cyclase or tyrosine kinase, an inherent enzymes which is always attached with the G protein, is performed. Let us see the figure. So this figure explains there will be a ligand or the hormone molecule which is ready to bind with the G protein coupled receptor. Actually, here the G protein coupled receptor is having 7 domains. It is a transmembrane coupled receptor, and this receptor is associated with the G protein, and G protein is formed of 3 subunits. Among these, alpha subunit is always associated with the GDP. While it is associated with the GDP, it is in an inactive stage. When it triggers adenyl cyclase, the AC, adenyl cyclase enzyme, it combines with GTP and become active. So more number of ATP molecules are utilized for this reaction, by which number of AMP, because dephosphorylation reactions is carried out. From triphosphate, it becomes monophosphate. So these monophosphate molecules, now it is called a cyclic AMP. They bind with another enzymatic protein family, which is called protein kinase A. I told you this protein kinase A is formed of regulatory domains and catalytic domains. The regulatory domains are having 2 binding sites. So each domain receives 4 pairs of cyclic AMP. After receiving the cyclic AMP, it activates a catalytic unit. This catalytic unit now enters into the nucleus, where it binds with Krebs protein. The Krebs protein is nothing but cyclic AMP response element binding protein. This Krebs protein involves further reactions. That means new proteins are synthesized. And the next process, next theory is called intracellular second messenger theory. We know that with reference to the mechanism of action of hormone, the hormone itself is called as a primary messenger. But after the binding of the primary messenger on its receptor of the target cell, it performs a series of reaction . One of the results of the action of the hormones is the formation of different types of secondary messengers. Here there are a list of secondary messengers have been tabulated or enlisted are cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, inositol triphosphate, diacylglycerol and calcium ions. These are considered as the secondary messengers which are formed by the cascade reactions stimulated by a primary messenger, the so-called hormone, after binding on its receptor. What are the functions of this CAMP? This CAMP acts as a second messenger, as I told you, which is essential for the action of the hormone adrenaline on hepatic tissues, by which the glucose level is increased. We know that adrenaline is secreted by the adrenal medulla of the adrenal gland, which is also named as emergency hormone. So at the time of emergency, our body requires more amount of glucose. In order to supply the glucose to the affected portions or affected body parts, the adrenaline immediately released from the adrenal medulla and they reaches the target cell, the hepatic tissues, where it binds and the series of reactions are carried out, as I have you mentioned. G protein is activated, further oval shaped adenylyl cyclase unit is activated, which stimulates another protein unit called protein kinase A, and finally new proteins are synthesized. These new proteins are nothing but the enzymes which are essential for the conversion of glycogen into glucose, by which the level of glucose is increased in our body after the binding of the adrenal gland on its target cell, so called the hepatic tissues. And the second example I have mentioned here is not reference to the hormone. This is the example for mentioning the role of cyclic AMP. Here, in case of slime mold, Dictyostelium discoideum, it is an amoeba shaped mold. When the food is scarce, when the food is plenty, the amoeba like Dictyostelium discoideum molds are found individually. But at the time of the scarce of the food, hundreds of or thousands of Dictyostelium discoideum joined together to form a slug-like appearance, a tree-like appearance, by means of accumulating one above other. All the amoeboid cells are form a slug-like appearance or a tree-like appearance, by which they can move from the place of food scare to the place where the food is plenty with the help of the somersault movement. So this association or integration of the various numbers of Dictyostelium discoideum is only because of the secretion of the adhesive proteins from its body called cadherins. The cadherins is secreted only after the level of secondary messenger, the so-called cyclic AMP, is increased in the body of the so-called Dictyostelium discoideum, the slime mold. And this is a figure to explain the formation of the cyclic AMP. Here you can see the hormone which binds on the receptor. Here you can see the receptor by which the G protein is activated, and adenyl cyclase is always activated. This adenyl cyclase triggers the protein kinase enzyme. For the action of the protein kinase enzyme, it requires ATP. When the ATP is used, it converts into AMP. When the level of the cyclic AMP increased, it involves the synthesis or the formation of new proteins. The new proteins may be the enzymes. And another second messenger formed during the action of hormone is called inositol triphosphate. Here inositol triphosphate is also considered as a second messenger, and which can be explained by the action of the hormone called calcitonin. Calcitonin is otherwise known as thyrocalcitonin. The role of the thyrocalcitonin is just opposite to the parathormone hormone secreted by the parathyroid gland. Calcitonin is mainly to maintain the calcium level in the plasma. When the plasma contains excess amount of calcium, it should be reduced by means of this calcitonin. This calcitonin binds on the surface of the bone cells, where it involves osteoclast activity by which the level of calcium in the plasma is maintained. And this calcium is essential for various types of reactions carried out in our body. And one of the important functions of the calcium which was secreted or found in the cytoplasm by the action of this hormone, which actuates the calmodulin, a non-muscular protein which is found in the spindle fibers. And after the binding of the calcium ions along with the calmodulin found in the spindle fibers, the separation of the chromosomes can be achieved. And this is a diagram to explain what will happen after the binding of the hormone calcitonin on its surface of the bone cells. Here you can see the hormone which binds on the surface of the target cell. Here there is a receptor, and near the receptor you can see an enzymatic unit that is called phospholipase C. Phospholipase C. This phospholipase C is converted into two components by the action of this phospholipase C after the binding of this hormone, which is called phosphatidyl inositol diphosphate. This phosphatidyl inositol diphosphate is further divided into diacyl glycerol and inositol triphosphate. This inositol triphosphate is essential for the secretion of another important secondary messenger, the so-called calcium. We know that endoplasm reticulum is a storehouse of the calcium. So this inositol triphosphate, the so-called secondary messenger formed from the phosphatidyl inositol diphosphate, which combined with the calmodulin. You know that calmodulin is a non-muscular protein found in the spindle fibers, which is meant for the normal cell division. You know that if the cell division doesn't occur normally, which leads to the problem called syndromes. So different types of syndromes will be formed when some hormones fail to bind on its specific receptors normally. And the next theory is gene activation theory. So this gene activation theory can be explained with the help of a steroid hormone. Here the steroid hormones have high affinity not only bind on the surface of the target cell, it has high affinity to bind on the surface of the nuclear receptors. So they directly enters into the nucleus where it binds with the nuclear receptors and finally reaches the nucleus where it binds with either DNA or RNA. Hence they are named as hormone response element. After binding on the initiator or the promoter or the operator region of the DNA, it stimulates a gene transcription reaction by which new proteins are synthesized. The best example is the action of the cortisol. Cortisol is nothing but the corticosteroid hormone which is secreted by the adrenal cortex region. When the cortisol level is excess in our body, it causes so many problems, but at the same time the excess cortisol is also help in the secretion of new proteins. That new proteins prevents the synthesis of lymphocytes during the time of graft transplantation. We know that during the time of graft transplantation, the graft rejection reactions will occur, which is very common in allograft transplantation. Even at that time, if our body contains excess amount of cortisol, this excess amount of cortisol reaches a target organ, is nothing but the graft, where it reduces the synthesis of lymphocytes by activating the formation of new protein called caspases. The caspases are nothing but the apoptotic proteins. They normally kills or reduces the synthesis of pre-B cells. The pre-B cells are the precursors for the formation of B lymphocytes, by which low antibody protection will occur, that will lead to the survival of the graft. So low antibody production here, not protection, production. Low antibody production will not kill the graft, by which graft can survive when our body contains excess amount of cortisol. So this is a figure that explains the role of this hormone, steroid hormone, corticosterone. Now this hormone, corticosterone, is bind on the surface of the target cell. From where it travels through the cytoplasm and finally it reaches the nucleus. After it enters into the nucleus, it binds with the nuclear material, hormone response element. After binding with the promoter or the operator region of the nucleus, it initiates the synthesis of proteins called caspases, by which it prevents or reduces the formation of pre-B cells, the so-called precursors of B lymphocytes, by which low amount of antibodies are secreted or produced. This low amount of antibodies will not hurt or will not disturb the developing graft, by which the graft can be survived for a longer time. So these are the mechanism of action of various hormones. And finally, I thank you very much for your patience listening. Thank you.